The summer of 1977 in New York City was one of three-figure temperatures, simmering tensions and creeping menace. A serial killer, the Son of Sam, was terrorizing all five boroughs, while the city was rocked by a crime wave and reeling from a fiscal crisis that had taken it to the brink of bankruptcy. Just as it was strained to its limit on the night of July the 13th, New York was hit by a total power blackout. The city was thrown into chaos. Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Sidney Schoenberg headed up the darkened newsroom for the New York Times that night, sending reporters to the trouble spots and writing copy by candlelight. He looks back on one of the most notorious and dangerous nights in the city's history, the New York 77 blackout.
For better or worse, New York of the 1970s was very different from the city it is today. Sin City. Fear City, it was called. It wasn't Metropolis. It was Gotham. The city was in a fiscal crisis, on the brink of bankruptcy. Poverty was severe. Crime was off the scales and the police were overwhelmed. There was a drug epidemic on the streets. People stopped using the subway at night. They were scared. As many as a million New Yorkers left the city for the suburbs. Then, on one sweltering night in the summer of 1977, as New York was being terrorized by the most notorious serial killer in its history, lightning struck the power system and the lights went out. The city was plunged into total darkness. It was gripped by a rampage of looting and arson that tore through the poorest neighborhoods. The fires and chaos threatened to spread. I'm Sidney Schoenberg, a journalist. I headed up the coverage that night for the New York Times. It was a night when radio played a huge part in keeping the city together, as we'll hear.
All we know at this juncture is that it is a citywide blackout, all the five boroughs affected.
State police have been sent into New York. National Guard units have been told to stand by in case they are needed.
They tell me that the generators there have blown. They are no longer accepting patients and apparently are in the dark.
The radio archive featured here was recorded live during the blackout, in the dark, often on battery-powered recorders. The sound quality is sometimes uneven.
From the police department. In light of tonight's citywide blackout, the department is asking all off-duty police officers to report to their nearest precinct immediately. This by order of police...
Music stations suddenly shifted to rolling news. Battery-powered transistor sets and car radios were New Yorkers' lifeline in the darkness. In this program, we'll hear the stories of New Yorkers who were in the city that night. A fireman, a taxi cab driver, a writer, a disco DJ, and a future mayor, among others, as well as my own.
You couldn't see, so now your other senses kicked in. You could hear hooting, howling, screaming, yelling, fighting, threats.
When the lights went out, you realized how dangerous it was because you heard every noise, you heard every footstep, you felt the danger. And you felt vulnerable, you felt alone, you just felt with every step could be your last step.
The fear was palpable in the dark, that anything could happen to you, that your chances of being attacked had just gone up astronomically. It had the odd effect of making me feel incredibly alone.
People were running, people were screaming, people were panicking, people were stuck on trains, people were running out of train stations, I guess after walking the tracks, people were stuck in apartment buildings and elevators. It took on a whole different feel. You felt the panic.
The blackout was the total breakdown of law and order. It was total. And you're totally at the mercy of forces that you don't want to be at the mercy of. You know, it's dark, it's hot. People are looting, and people are running around the street with, you know, whatever weapons of one sort or another. And it's like you're in a state of nature. That's as far down as civil life can go.
When the blackout occurred, you could see the piranha-like effect on people. It's like, wow, this is our opportunity. This is the lottery. Take it now, because if we don't take it, others will. And so instead of having self-constraint, people became instantly lawless. People who never had committed a criminal act all of a sudden went on rampages. It was an aura, a feeling of survival of the fittest. It was almost a jungle-like scenario of predators versus victims.
In the summer of 1977, I was a metropolitan editor, a fancy name for the city editor of the New York Times. The Times newsroom was a big, old-fashioned open space without any dividers. It buzzed with the noise of clacking typewriters and ringing telephones. On the night of the blackout, July 13th, I'd finished work and turned over the city desk to the night crew. I was having dinner with a friend not far from the Times. The restaurant suddenly went dark. And then the block went dark. And then the whole city. We hoofed it straight back to the newsroom. On our way, store owners were already nailing wooden boarding over their shop fronts, afraid of their windows getting smashed, worried about the night ahead.
Hi-ho, hey-hey, chew your little troubles away.
1977 wasn't the first blackout in New York City's history. There had been an earlier one in 1965, which I covered as a reporter.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special report on the power failures. The blackout affected such centers as Toronto, London, Ontario, New York, Boston, and hundreds of smaller communities.
I was assigned to roam around the city. Later that night, my editor sent me to the Con Edison headquarters. It was interesting to see how panicked the power company officials were. They knew they'd be blamed for the power failure, whether it was their fault or not.
This week, WABC proudly presents these super hit sounds, the McCoys.
Glenn Morgan was program director of WABC New York.
In 1965, during that blackout, it occurred while Dan Ingram was on the air at WABC in the afternoon drive slot. At that time, we were using cartridge tape playback machines. All the records were transferred to cartridge tape, so we wouldn't have a bunch of scratchy records on the air. And all of a sudden, all of the music started slowing down on the radio station.
The lights are dimming in the studio. You wouldn't believe what's going on in the studio, folks. The lights are getting dim. The electricity is slowing down.
In 1965, the year of the first blackout, New York was in a very different place.
Throughout the affected area, officials report no significant increase in either deaths, injuries, or acts of violence.
Thousands slept either underground or aboard stalled.
The feeling was one of overall cooperation. No major budget problems. More or less a safe city in which to live. It was nothing like the chaos that erupted in 1977. Danny Krivit was a DJ in the downtown disco scene.
The first blackout, the city is massively overcrowded. It's growing really fast, but a lot of stuff is new. Feelings are new. Diversity is new. Ghettos and new immigrants are still new and forming. I think everybody got off in the energy of a very happening city. So by the time 77 comes along, the city was in financial problems. The social services and a lot of the services in New York had degraded to really low levels. I mean, you take for granted that the streets are bright, but the streets were generally dark at night. Street lights look like an old movie with a kind of foggy light in the distance, you know. There were a lot of shadows on the street. You know, people surprise you very easily. And it was a real problem because if you were in trouble, the average New Yorker was not going to help you. The police had their hands full. You rarely ran into a policeman when you needed him. Somebody wanted to commit a crime or take something, they just did it.
In 77, New York City was a mess.
Professor Mike Wallace founded the Gotham Center for New York City History at City University, New York.
it was reeling from several years of imposed fiscal austerity. There had been tremendous cutbacks in the police department, in the fire department, in the schools, in sanitation, in welfare payments. The rate of poverty was exploding at an incredible level. New York had been relatively prosperous, and now it was in fact relatively poor. So to find the city erupting in the way that it did in 77 is not a great surprise.
Yes. Yeah, that was sort of a weird deal.
When you add up all the paper that says New York owes somebody something, it's a debt that comes to $12 billion. That debt load is the immediate cause of New York's fiscal crisis. Now the question has arisen, having borrowed so much money, can New York pay it back?
You have, in fact, less money coming in, more money going out, and the solution to that for New York City, as it was for the United States, as it was for most major corporations, as it was for most third world countries, was you borrowed.
Former mayor of New York, Ed Koch.
I don't know what the numbers were, but Abeam was not a popular mayor at the time. He was running for re-election. Many, many people thought he was responsible for the financial debacle.
The fiscal fate that has befallen the city was foreordained. New York City has paid the price thousands of times over of the one-way bus tickets that propelled people without money, without skills, without hope into our town from all over the United States.
He spent more money than the city was taking in terms of the operational budget. And you can't spend money that you don't have unless you go out and borrow it. And you shouldn't, except for construction, but not for operating the expenses.
If you do have any people that are interested in them, I think you can tell them they'll be better than a seven.
What you do is you come up with some fancy accounting devices. So you develop new kind of financial instruments, like tax anticipation revenue bonds.
You know, a lot of discussions with customers that I had sold New York City bonds to in notes.
So you don't actually have the money, but you know that you're good for it because you've got the taxing power. It's sustainable as long as the long boom of the post-war continues. But then it doesn't. And then, no question, there was creative accounting taking place here.
There was mass humiliation. This, the crown jewel of all cities in the world, New York, suddenly was sliding into fiscal dissolvement because we had no more money.
Curtis Sliwa founded the Guardian Angels, volunteers who patrolled New York City's subways.
The elected officials were so corrupt that when they were dropped dead and you would have a wake, you couldn't even close the casket. You would need a Black and Decker power tool to drill them into the ground. They had put their beaks in the trough and taken so much money, there was nothing left. So the mayor, Abeam, who needed to step on 10 telephone books to be seen, he was basically a midget and didn't exude any confidence, went to the president at the time, Gerald Ford, and asked that the federal government bail out New York City.
We are not asking for a handout. We're asking for equal treatment in times of extraordinary economic and social pressures.
And President Gerald Ford at the time said, drop dead, New York City. It would be better if you went into Chapter 11 and you pulled yourself up by the bootstraps. Now, New Yorkers took great offense to this. They consider this a slap in the face.
In a letter to Mayor Abeam, the president said federal assistance would do nothing but postpone, in his words, coming to grips with the problem.
There can be no doubt where the real responsibility lies. And when New York City now asks the rest of the country to guarantee its bills, it can be no surprise that many other Americans ask why.
New Yorkers were appalled by a cover of Time magazine which showed Abeam dressed like a beggar and holding out a cup asking for charity. And we were ashamed.
Foreign correspondents covering our city hall are incredulous to learn that the world's richest nation could abandon its preeminent city. Would the French disown Paris? Or the British allow London to become insolvent? Would the Soviets abandon Moscow?
We owed $6 billion in short-term debt. $1 billion a year was borrowed to make up the difference between what the city took in and what it was spending. The banks decided after about 6 years of lending money that way, never being repaid, always rolling over the debt, that they were never going to be paid. And so they said, we're not going to lend you another nickel. And they stopped. They closed the window on loans for the city.
To placate the financial community, Mayor Beam had put a freeze on all municipal hiring and laid off many New York City employees, the first time this had happened since the Depression. Beam took 38,000 city workers off the rolls, including cops, firemen, and garbage collectors. Firehouses were shuttered and closed in areas that had the worst problems with arson attacks. Afraid of more layoffs, the police union began to distribute Welcome to Fear City leaflets at Kennedy Airport and Grand Central Station. The leaflets urged tourists not to ride the subways and not to leave their hotels after dark. Professor Mike Wallace.
This is the moment which a million whites had fled the city and taken their tax dollars with them, and a million blacks and Hispanics had arrived. The fears of crime, the fears of danger on the street were at red-hot levels. That's the issue that the blackout becomes the symbol of. Its real significance is in this demographic and political and cultural upheaval that's taking place.
People were frightened. The city was nervous. Tabloid headline fonts are much larger than broadsheets, and day after day those front-page headlines blared out at you. But it wasn't a tabloid fiction. Crime was indeed high, and the city's law enforcement wasn't equipped to deal with it. NYPD, the largest municipal police department in the world, didn't have the technology or manpower to get a grip on the waves of break-ins, muggings, arson, and shootings. Curtis Sliwa.
76, 77, there were certain key sectors of the outer boroughs, mostly the outer boroughs. The entire South Bronx was devastated, and many of the men would graduate to go on to prison. Then you moved to Brooklyn, which was renamed Crooklyn. These were two neighborhoods that would consistently produce many of the criminals who would graduate into the state correctional facility. Harlem, up north, which was a ghetto, and the Lower East Side, the alphabet jungle, avenues A, B, and C, in which dope fiends would roam about like if they were in the movie Dawn of the Dead, mostly at night, but also during the day. They would line up so that they could sell nickel and dime bags of heroin, and they would be injecting right up into the streets.
DJ Danny Crivet.
The movies that set the tone, kind of an extreme tone of the era, were Death Wish and Island of New York. And they basically, you know, made it seem like New York's a scary place. I mean, just like in a movie, you just figure somebody could be kicking in your door. So having a good lock, or maybe a second good lock, wasn't quite the answer. You felt like somebody wants to come in, they're going to get in. They're just going to keep kicking and the door's going to come off. So they got this other lock that had a bar that propped up against the door and locked into the floor. And that was your ultimate security. Or they had another one that had two bars that went across the door sideways and locked into either wall. Those were supposed to keep someone from actually ramming your door down. I mean, if they had a ram, they were getting in, but just kicking your door down, that was probably going to stop them.
When you look at the amount of bombs that went into Dresden, you know, in that such a short period of time and how much destruction it did, there was probably as much destruction that occurred in the city of New York by the burn, baby, burn mentality.
Dennis Smith was a firefighter with the Fire Department of New York.
There was block after block of these burned out buildings, and people were destroying their property for all kinds of reasons, whether it was bad landlords to get insurance or just political radicals just to make a point. It was a city that was very much in distress, if not really in its final breaths. But the city was burning, that's for sure.
We were leading up into a long, hot summer again. The Bronx continued to burn down. The South Bronx had whole quadrants, as if there had been some kind of night bombing
that had occurred overnight. You would wake up in the morning and you would smell the remnants of buildings that the day before had been up and operating. Four-story, five-story tenements completely burnt to the ground. Arson for hire. Landlords trying to get on their insurance money real quick, and they would hire the local gangbangers who would boldly and brazenly walk into a building with a pail of gasoline and a match, and in Spanish and English, warn everyone, you got 5 minutes to clear out. Grab everything you can, we're torching the building.
Rewards totaling $20,000 have been offered in New York City for information leading to the arrest of Son of Sam, the .44 caliber killer.
The mood of the city wasn't good. Even before we learned there was a serial killer on the loose.
His shootings have struck terror into some normally quiet neighborhoods of Queens and the Bronx in the last 11 months. The attacker's latest victims are 20-year-old Salvatore Lupo and 17-year-old Judy Placido, who were injured last weekend.
763 to 3 homicide base J.
Judy and Salvatore survived the attack, as did four other victims of this madman. Five other victims were not so lucky. They lie buried in cemeteries here in Queens and across the river in the Bronx. Similar fear has spread throughout this city.
The Daily News provided the most vivid coverage of the Summer of Sam. They had the case as their banner headline on a regular basis, and not just because the paper was a tabloid. The killer had written to one of their columnists, Jimmy Breslin, a wild letter signed Son of Sam, where he confessed to the killings and declared, "I am a monster." It took months to catch him.
Son of Sam was going around shooting girls with long, dark hair.
David DePino was a hairdresser in the Bronx.
And that was perceived by all the young girls. So I was very busy at that time, cutting girls' hair short, making them blonde or red. I had lines of girls lined up, waiting for haircuts, make my hair blonde. Mothers forcing their kids to cut their hair because they didn't want to look like the type Sam was killing.
And the manhunt goes on.
I think he's a person who, despite his psychological problems, is cunning and canny, and he knows how to prepare for what he does and get away with it.
He was the boogeyman. Sam was the boogeyman. You didn't know where he was because he was going borough to borough. He was shooting guys as well as girls. No specific spot. It was a panic. It was panicking. He scared the city. I could only equate it to stories and books I read of Jack the Ripper, how Sam terrorized New York City, from Connecticut to the Bronx to Brooklyn to Staten Island to Queens to Manhattan. It was everywhere.
Broadcaster and journalist Kurt Loder.
People were terrified. It was a terrifying time. It was a very different New York. New York in the 70s was more colorful than it is today, I think. There was a lot of prostitution. It was pretty much out in the open, especially in Times Square. It was a little dangerous to go out in late at night. You could go into restaurants and do lines off the tables, and it would just happen. And who would do anything about it? I mean, people spent half their dinner time in the bathroom doing cocaine. It was just everywhere. Famously, Studio 54, which they had just opened recently, had a giant Coke spoon that lifted up to a sort of a man in the moon sculpture up by the ceiling, and that was sort of the theme of the whole place, and it was like a Coke palace. So it was really much more out in the open, and you could call marijuana boys to come deliver stuff to you, or people would deliver cocaine too. I mean, New York today is unrecognizable from what it was in the 70s.
That summer, it all came together. On top of the crime wave, New York was baking in unusual heat. The temperatures got so high, the concrete cracked on some streets. All five boroughs were on edge. Just as the anxiety was at what we thought was its limit, New York's generators buckled. The city was suddenly plunged into pitch darkness. Joe Petta was working at Con Edison's main office in Manhattan.
Don't forget now, it's a very hot, muggy July night. Air conditioning is going full bore. it's late, so all the lights are on, the air conditioning is on, the load is very high. What started this whole chain of events was a series of lightning strikes that hit our northern Westchester transmission tower. And that was at 8:37 p.m. Almost 20 minutes later, at 8:55, a second series of lightning strikes short-circuited out two more of the 345,000 volt lines coming in from Westchester. About 5 minutes later, at 9 o'clock, efforts were undertaken to start reducing the load, which was now too high for the amount of power that was available. That proved completely ineffective. At 9:19, we lost the last remaining high voltage transmission link. There's a short, and the circuit breakers on those systems are now all tripping. At almost 9:30, one of our major power plants in the city automatically shuts down. Another major power plant is affected. It shuts down automatically, and by 9:36, the entire system goes dark. The city is in complete black.
Over the city, pilots saw runways disappear beneath them. Under the city, subway trains stopped, motionless between stations. Across all five boroughs, traffic lights blinked out.
It was a hot, sweltering night, and then all of a sudden, you saw the twinkling of the lights, and out everything went.
Mayor Abraham Beam of New York City has declared a state of emergency because of a massive power blackout in the nation's largest city.
Suddenly, everything stopped.
Franklin, a major problem has popped up in the city of New York, as you well know.
Poet and writer Charlotte Carter.
I assumed that it was the fuse box blowing again, so I traipsed downstairs to a neighbor, and he was the one who informed me that his lights had gone out, and we looked out of his window, and there was blackness.
All we know at this juncture is that it is a citywide blackout, all the five boroughs affected.
We have most, if not all, of New York City without normal power, save for emergency generators where they do exist.
The East River Drive, I'm going south with a passenger. I'm going to get off at Grand Street.
Arthur Farrier drove a New York yellow cab.
And then I'm headed north, empty, in the East Village. And I notice that several blocks in front of me are blacked out. Not behind me, to the left or right, but I see patches of blocks going dark.
We're trying to get you as much information as soon as possible. We're at WYNS on Park Avenue, and we're operating on emergency power. And as soon as we have more details on that blackout, we'll bring them to you.
People are starting to scramble on the street. They want to get home. They need a taxi. People are grabbing me left and right.
State police have been sent into New York. National Guard units have been told to stand by in case they are needed.
You could sense the panic in the traffic. There's no traffic lights, so cars are kind of jaggedly stopping and starting because they don't know why everything's dark. Of course, your radio's out. Then you scramble for batteries to get a portable radio going, or you start shouting across the avenue to people who are walking on the street, and no one knows what's happening.
Con Edison worker Joe Petta.
I remember very clearly that the only way the streets were illuminated were by car headlights. There were no lights anywhere. We had no lights in this building. People were working by flashlight. Outside, it was pitch black. It was eerie. It was otherworldly in a way that, you know, you had never seen the city in darkness. This is the city that never sleeps. Times Square in the middle of the night is as bright as it is in the middle of the day. And the entire city was illuminated by automobile headlights and candles, which were virtually ineffective outside. There were no lights. It was virtually pitch black everywhere you went.
The adrenaline kicked in the moment I got into the newsroom. It was clear the entire city was dark. My job was to look at the list of reporters and send them immediately to various parts of the city, some according to their expertise, others simply as street reporters. This was done in the space of perhaps 15 minutes. It was automatic. You knew you had to be everywhere, and you knew you had to have reporters on the streets, however dangerous.
Gil, some of the difficulties we're having this evening in piecing together this story, the computerized operations at both of the wire services here in New York City are down. We have restored power, emergency power now, to our wire room, and nothing but gibberish in some of the wires is coming in. The initial bulletin from AP in Newark says that at least two of the boroughs have been hit. We know that it goes beyond that, affecting at least all five boroughs.
Got back to the state. The lobby was dark. Ran up 8 flights of stairs. And fortunately, WABC was still on the air.
Former WABC program director, Glenn Morgan.
The first thing I did when I arrived at the station was to go into the news director's office and ask what is going on. I got a quick synopsis that the entire city was without power. I ran down the hall into my office. I turned on my radio. I scanned the dial, and WABC was just about, I believe, the only station that was on the air.
There is no indication how widespread this is.
So I called my general manager at home. I said, what are we going to do? I think I need to change format to all news, forget the music. The city needs us.
All right, let me bring you up to date as to exactly what happened, all right? At 9:29 tonight, New York was hit with a massive power failure.
He said something like, when it's your damn station, you're the operations and program director, you think you want to change to all news? Just do it. What are you bothering me for? Just do it. So I'm looking around. We are a music station. We have been cutting back newscasts to sharpen our competitive edge. And we had a skeleton staff, really, of news people in the newsroom. So I had to coordinate with our news director to use them most effectively to get out there, make the calls, get the information, assemble the information, report the information.
We would beg you, please do not use the telephones unless it is absolutely essential. Please do not call your friends and ask, where were you when the lights went out? No one's going to tell you the truth anyway if they weren't home. It's 11:11 on WABC. I'm George Michael. The night the lights went out was this night, July the 13th, 1977. The power officially went off.
Radio DJ Dan Ingram, who had anchored WABC's coverage of the 1965 blackout, called the station on air to give an impromptu eyewitness report.
Dan Ingram, we just arrived home in Oyster Bay. Let's switch now to that report with Dan Ingram.
George, it was one of the weirdest scenes of my life since the last time this happened. Driving through the upper level of the 59th Street Bridge, I had the strange feeling, looking at all that metalwork around me, that I was driving through the bones of some dead brontosaurus, and I felt very weird. And right up in front of me on the end of the 59th Street Bridge were lightning bolts coming down like a scene from a promotional movie for King Kong. It really felt strange. It was like God was saying, you're really amateurs, folks.
David DePino.
You made a turn in the village and looked at a whole block full of stoops with hundreds and hundreds of candles and people's headlights on and music from car radios and boomboxes and people dancing and fanning themselves because it was so hot and the rhythmic sounds. Ice cream stores were giving ice cream away for free because it was all melting. Soda people were out giving sodas and waters to people walking around and stars bursting because the city was black. You looked up for the first time and you saw millions of stars in the sky that you normally couldn't see because of the lights of the city. It was beautiful.
And all the lights were down. And it was far out. Was it great? And the audience was fantastic. They just all sat there nice and quiet. And the band kept playing and Pete and the actors got on stage and they danced. But it was far out. It was wonderful.
Come on!
Hi, TV.
Hi, Mom.
Danny Krivin.
During the blackout, I'm living on 12th Street looking out downtown over Greenwich Village. And the World Trade Centers were relatively new buildings. You know, they were kind of there in the shadows. Well, I'm looking out over my view, and I actually ventured outside, and kind of like years before, there were stores open and bars open with candles and trying to welcome people. But there was a distinctly different vibe. You were already hearing that there was trouble in other parts of the city.
I said to the neighbor, oh, wait a minute, I heard someone jump onto the skylight. It never occurred to me there was going to be looting, rioting, or anything like that. Because you always think, oh, the lights will come on in a minute or two. It'll be okay in 10 minutes, because that's what happens when you blow a fuse. You know, the problem's going to be solved in a few minutes, that somebody will show up and fix everything. But they didn't. And then it went on overnight.
The vibe in the village was I would walk around and I felt a little bit anxious. And I could tell when I went in places, people weren't at ease. They felt anxious too. In 1977, even in Greenwich Village, you felt a little leery. You know, you walk with eyes back of your head. Right next to Greenwich Village, the East Village was a couple of blocks, because as soon as you got past First Avenue, you would cross the border, it was Alphabet City. And it was very violent. And you thought if you ventured there in the blackout, I mean, you were just not coming back.
And it got later, it got to 11, 11:30, 12. And the whole mood, the whole feeling changed. It was like when you go to a movie and you're watching a suspense movie and you know now the killer's coming and you... Dum, 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 dum. People were running, people were screaming, people were panicking, people were stuck on trains, people were running out of train stations, I guess after walking the tracks. People were stuck in apartment buildings and elevators. It took on a whole different feel. You felt the panic, and we realized the magnitude of what was happening.
Kenny, Kenny, down, Kenny, down, come on, come on, wait, come on.
I wasn't on the streets. I'd set up operations using flashlights, battery lanterns, and candles in the darkened newsroom of the Times, and was directing the coverage from there. The first reports were coming in, and they sounded very hairy. Each reporter was essentially operating on their own. Back at the newsroom, we had to piece together their individual reports to try and see the bigger picture. It's not easy to assess the seriousness of a rampage when you're sitting in a darkened office without power, trying to figure out how big a story it is while it's still unfolding. But we knew very quickly it was serious. Little by little, we began to make sense of the stories of looting and violence coming in. I wasn't shocked by the violence that night. I was a hard person to shock. I'd been a war correspondent in Indochina, and I'd seen worse. But it seemed like an endless night. Founder of the Guardian Angels, Curtis Sliwa.
Within seconds, he saw mobs literally running up and down the street. And they went to the jewelry stores, and they went to the sneaker stores. They tore the iron railings off of the front of the store and basically bashed their way in through the glass windows and stole everything they could get their hands on. And then to cover up their crimes, they torched it. And then they went to the furniture stores on the Grand Concourse and did likewise. So what was happening was open looting. They were like locusts going through a cornfield. The problem was, is that at each and every turn, they wouldn't just sack the store and steal everything they could get their hands on. They would torch it to boot.
What happened?
People are at the radio clinic.
They just broke into the place?
That's right. They break everything.
you're closing your store now here.
I have to close the store because it's very dangerous. Very dangerous. It's very bad neighborhood. Again.
Well, obviously, people were stealing stuff from in there.
Yeah, they were.
What were they getting?
TV.
Because I saw a bunch of people walking down the street with air conditioners.
Well, I seen that man there, the one that got up against the wall by the neck. He went to tell them something. Now they arrested him.
Come on!
Taxi driver Arthur Farrier.
The mood varied a lot from neighborhood to neighborhood. Downtown, from the East Village, up through Midtown, people were acting normally or reasonably. But once I got to the Upper West Side, which was a predominantly residential neighborhood and with many low-income projects, you could feel the difference. You can hear what was going on. Besides the plate glass windows crashing, stores are going to be hit, you hear gunfire. I distinctly heard gunfire. Since I was in the Army in the mid-60s, I went through basic training. I know what that sounds like. And that's when I decided to quit for the evening and head back to my garage.
I've been here all night, and the police was firing. I mean, it's been terrible.
Police are now back at the store, which they just left a moment ago. This is a different set of police. You heard this people run away a minute ago, and now the police are threatening anybody inside. Well, we're just watching now someone being arrested who was in the store. I haven't seen anybody go in yet. There's people coming out of the store now with stuff.
Former mayor of New York, Ed Koch.
What I said was, and what I believe then, what I believe now, that if the city doesn't have an adequate police force, and it wasn't adequate in those days to deal with this general looting, then call in the National Guard. That can only be done by the governor, but you have to ask him. And that's what I did. I said, call in the National Guard, but it has to be the mayor who asks him. Abe didn't ask him.
The grates that come down over the side of the store here have been jerked, physically forced up.
Forced up.
And bent outwards. There's broken glass all over the place. Now, having picked up two alleged looters, the police cars, these two police cars have now gone away, and the people are now back.
Message from the police department. In light of tonight's citywide blackout, the department is asking all off-duty police officers to report to their nearest precinct immediately. This by order.
Police officers on the front line busting their shoes were waiting for orders from headquarters. They never came. There was disarray. The communication lines broke down, and the command structure broke down. So it left cops to fend for themselves. And most cops didn't want to rock the boat. Most cops didn't want to take the law into their own hands. Most cops decided better to retreat and come back for a better day than to risk their life in the streets for people, particularly vendors and retailers, many of whom were absentee landlords, many of whom were really not running their stores, were living in the plush suburbs and didn't even bother to come in to visit the stores, even after the police had called them to let them know, hey, your store's been looted, your store's been robbed, there are no more possessions, your store's been burnt to the ground.
How are we holding up? There are enough police, I assume, to take care of any eventualities that may happen.
Police officers are reporting to their respective precincts, and a lot of officers have responded during the night.
Now, we had a lot of reports of a lot of looting, especially in the Manhattan area. I understand the South Bronx is pretty bad.
As of this time, I have the number of arrests, and it is approximately over 2,000 in New York City so far. A breakdown would be in Manhattan, there are over 500 arrests. In Brooklyn, there are over 700 arrests. Queens, there are over 100 arrests. In the Bronx, there's well over 600 arrests. 81 members of the service were injured last night, and one was shot.
In Manhattan, there were skirmishes and pillaging along Avenues A, B, and C in Alphabet City. Between 63rd and 110th Street, 61 stores were ransacked. The Bronx was hit harder still, with hundreds of stores damaged and almost 1,000 arrests. The situation was just as bad in Brooklyn. Williamsburg, Brownsville, Flatbush Avenue, and Bushwick were all badly hit. There were fires across the city.
John, Acting Fire Commissioner Stephen Murphy has just issued an immediate callback for all of the off-duty firemen and fire officers who are scheduled to report for duty at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning.
FDNY firefighter Dennis Smith.
I went up to one firehouse on 86th Street and 3rd Avenue, and I thought, well, at least it's a close-by firehouse. I can work with them and borrow somebody's helmet and boots or something, but I couldn't find them. They were absolutely nowhere to be found. They were out at the various jobs. Every firehouse was emptied out. But, you know, fires always occur in relation to some kind of a crisis in these places where people are living who are largely overcrowded and not happy and at that period of time very alienated against the government anyway. So it was just a way for them to express or to vent the anger of their situation.
Oh, that's baloney. People took advantage of a blackout. They wanted to steal. They weren't looting stores for food. They were looting stores for liquor, for cameras, for sneakers, for shoes. No. It had nothing to do with the pent-up, built-up animosity. Had to do with the fact that people thought they could get away with it.
It was like a war scene. There were hundreds and hundreds of wild people breaking windows, grabbing the gates. The police
couldn't... What were they doing in the York shop?
Well, they broke all the windows. And then they were pounding on the gates. Then a car pulled up. A chain hit one of the gates. They ripped the gate down. And, I mean, there was just no stopping them.
Now, were you cleaned out?
I don't think they took one of the telephones, and my carpet is still there, but you'd be hard-pressed to find any sign there that this was ever a stereo store.
Curtis Sliwa.
Grab what you can, when you can. You weren't going to rat anyone out. You weren't going to drop dime. You weren't going to cooperate with the authorities. So a lot of those materials openly were being sold out in the streets in a black market style, Alibaba and the 40 Thieves way. And the police were not even cracking down on that. Imagine just setting up an impromptu flea market and selling all the items that you knew had been stolen from the stores that had been burnt down just blocks away. It was disgrazia.
The New York Times is a newspaper that prides itself on publishing every day. But we had no idea whose presses were going to print it. Ours went dead with the blackout. Luckily, the Bergen Record, across the Hudson River in northern New Jersey, opened its presses to us. No other paper in New York that night got a full edition out. Besides, this was a huge story. In fact, there were lots of stories. Trains stuck in tunnels, people trapped in elevators. How did hospitals function? Patients were revived by handheld airbags pumped back and forth. Surgery was carried out by generator-run lamps in hospital parking lots. We carried a picture of that on the front page, in fact.
We're attempting to find out right now just what the New York City Transit Authority is doing in regard to, undoubtedly, the many people who happen to be on subway trains at the time. Hospitals, in many cases, of course, do have emergency generators.
The Mets were playing. The lights went out at Chase Stadium, and I just got to Kennedy Airport on the Belt Parkway, and Kennedy Airport suddenly went black, and that was it.
Speaking of that, three of our candles just went out. At most radio stations, they build the actual studios and news facilities in the inner sanctums where there are no windows because that's where the best soundproofing is. You're using candle power and flashlight power in here.
We typed our copy by flashlight and candlelight or phoned it in to transcribers. The hard copy was then carried over to New Jersey in trucks and cars to be printed. It was exciting. Like a relay race, when you have to pass the baton to the next runner. There was lots of ego, plenty of adrenaline, and I must say, without wishing to crow, I felt really very good that we managed to publish a full press run. That night, no one could match us.
We have been here since last night. We are still here, bringing you everything you need to know about an incredible story in New York City, the Great Blackout of 1977. But this time the lights went out and they have stayed out here in Midtown Manhattan for, well, I guess about 12 hours now. Our clock stopped here in the WHN newsroom at 9:29:34 last night. It is now 9:22 and a few seconds in New York City, so we are approaching the 12-hour mark.
The sun rose on New York, and the extent of the riot damage and other losses was clear. Con Ed came in for some heavy criticism, but there was no precise scapegoat. Instead, there was much hand-wringing over the vandalism, and lots of litigation, too.
As soon as we get the situation stabilized, obviously the governor is going to have to take a look at this and see what can be done. This is just intolerable. And it goes to the very heart of a society or a city's ability to survive.
Well, Joe Bragg has said it, Steven Berger has said it, Alfred Del Bello has said it, Abraham David Beam has said it, and I suspect that in the days ahead, a lot of people are going to be saying it again and again. Why do we need Con Ed?
Well, certainly those who have been the more vocal critics of the utility have more ammunition for their next volleys.
Con Edison worker Joe Petta.
At the time, Mayor Beam accused Con Edison of gross negligence, and that was the approach that City Hall was taking toward the company around this event.
I want to express first my total outrage that at this hour, the city of New York is still without power. And given what occurred 12 years ago, Con Ed's performance is at the very least gross negligence, and at the worst, far more serious.
Clearly, from our perspective, it was not gross negligence. It was an act of God over which we had no control. We did the best we could to stop the event, and we just couldn't stop it. But we didn't feel that it was negligence.
They talked about the necessity of going very slowly with that restoration because of the surge possibility.
They have to take it branch by branch, limb by limb, to make sure that the entire system does not blow out all over again. They have to experiment with one area and then another area of the power grid.
Lights are coming on all over the place. We're getting ourselves back to normal in New York City.
Thursday, July 14th, 1977.
Suddenly, light and brightness out of a 24-hour darkness. The bright patchwork of the second night of the great New York energy crisis of 1977. At this moment, more than 90% of the electrical power has been restored in greater New York. 12,000 police are on the street compared to the normal 2,500. By 9:30, over 3,000 people have been arrested for looting and disorderly conduct. 250 state troopers are in the city for traffic control. One policeman has been shot and wounded. 87 suffered other injuries. There have been 40 firemen injured in 650 fires. There is 65% of the service on the subways right now. No more is expected for the morning rush hour. We are standing by for reports from various locations.
We are down in the village, and I am very pleased to report that at about 10:20, the last of the lights down here, starting with 15th Street, pow, pow, down the blocks are going on. If they haven't got all the way south, you folks, they're coming. I think
David DePino.
Was it the exact moment when things turned? Did that force the turn? But I can remember pre-77 blackout, after 77 blackout, and there were definitely two worlds. New York definitely changed. And it could have just been the sign of a new decade of the 80s coming, or it could have been the capturing of Sam. It could have been passing the blackout and surviving it, or all the above. How do you really know for sure? But it did change.
Former mayor of New York, Ed Koch.
It was the next morning when you saw the pictures of the gutted stores and the arson. And people were angry, as they had every right to be. The blackout helped me get elected because I stood up and said, we cannot allow people to engage in lawlessness without paying the penalty of being arrested and hopefully punished by the courts.
A few months later, in November of 1977, Ed Koch was elected the new mayor of New York. He was popular. He had a lot of energy. He wasn't a machine politician, and he presented himself very much as a man of the people. New Yorkers like to think they're tough and resilient, but that summer people knew the city was in dire shape. Koch was trying to lift its spirits, and he did.
Koch apparently impressed the voters by his compulsive work habits. A bachelor, he's been described as married to his work. When it came to the mayoral race, Koch built on this reputation. He worked the streets constantly. He promised competence, not charisma or clubhouse favors.
Well, Abraham Beam was like an accountant you would go to handle your taxes. People looked at him, what a poo-putt.
Curtis Sliwa.
He was a guy who just did not exude any confidence in himself, never mind in the residents of the city of New York and in the midst of the blackout. Now, Ed Koch came in, and all of a sudden, he was the 32nd soundbite mayor.
And I needed the cooperation of the people of the city of New York, and I had to convince them. And I did it by saying to them, if you follow me, I will lead you across the desert. And they believed it, and I did.
He walked, he talked, he squawked. He was into I and me. He had such a humongous ego, you needed a crane to get him in and out of a room. But he was an eccentric character, and New Yorkers identified with him. And he certainly helped the morale of the city through additional tough times, but you knew that he would take control, whereas A. Beam was just missing in action.
Critic and novelist Lynn Tillman.
New York's specialness is its virtue and its vice. And one of the things about New Yorkers is, I think, that these are people who have stories to tell, and they want to narrate their lives. anything that's dramatic in the city becomes part of why the city is exciting, part of the narrative that New Yorkers tell themselves about why we live in the city. And so then the blackout, we become part of that larger narrative and add to it.
Since the 1977 blackout, New York has suffered a few more outages, but only one was citywide. Measured by violence, fear, chaos, magnitude, and yes, even excitement. The New York City blackout of 1977 stands alone.
New York 77 Blackout was presented by Sidney Schoenberg. It was produced by Simon Hollis and was a Brooke Lapping production for BBC Radio 4.